Good morning. Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the chamber and across the campus? The first item of business is general questions. Question number one, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on the level of ambulance cover across Mid Scotland and Fife.
Cabinet Secretary Hamza Youssef.
Cover across Fife from today until month end is an average of 92.4. In addition to this, we have additional resources planned and added as required. For example, two additional shifts in Fife tomorrow and similar across the weekend. This will be further supplemented with overtime as uptake will continue to grow throughout the month. Cover recently is 94.2 and across Fife specifically it's over 92.6. We have supported through £20 million of investment the service and recruiting an additional 296 frontline staff. Across Fife this will equate to an additional 442 double crewed ambulance hours every single week. Nationally, the Scottish Ambulance Service, of course, as we all know, is experiencing extraordinary demand and the NHS under significant challenge as a result. Excuse me, Presiding Officer. Despite the pressure coronavirus has brought upon our ambulance service, which serves some of the most rural areas in the UK, in 2020-21, crews responded to over 70% of highest priority calls in under 10 minutes and more than 99% in under 30 minutes.
Murdo Fraser.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response? Constituents were raising concerns with me about the level of ambulance cover, particularly in rural areas, even before the COVID pandemic. And it's clear the situation is now much more serious, despite the efforts of all ambulance staff. This morning's newspaper headlines make grim reading, with people now dying as a result of ambulance delays. This has become a national crisis. When will the Cabinet Secretary get a grip on this issue before more lives are needlessly lost?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say what I agree with Murdo Fraser is the scale of not just the challenge, but of course he is right to say that the newspapers, not just today, but I know there have been a number of cases that have been raised by members, do make for grim reading. He will not get a defence from me on some of those unacceptable waiting times. And the Ambulance Service, of course, too, is very much aware of that. What I want to try to do, give Murdo Fraser an assurance of is that nobody is sitting on their hands. That's why we have invested that additional £20 million. Ambulance staff, including paramedics, technicians, have been recruited, including in the north and in the east region. More will come on board during the winter months. What I plan to do with Parliament's approval is come forward on Tuesday with a further parliamentary statement giving out some of the detail of the other actions that we're looking to bring forward to help ambulance service in remote and rural areas, but right across the country as well. I'm happy, if there are specific instances or cases that members have that they'd like me to look at as Cabinet Secretary for Health, of course, any member can send me the details of those cases.
Call Willie Rennie.
Staff morale is at rock bottom just now. They are feeling the inordinate pressure. And this investment, to be frank, comes far too late, because Murdo Fraser's right. The problems were evident before the pandemic. So what I need to understand from the Minister is why those decisions about investment and recruiting staff were not made years ago when they should have been.
Cabinet Secretary.
So I'd say to Willie Rennie, I'm happy to provide further detail. We have that investment is from years ago. That investment started 18 months ago. So it started at the very beginning of the pandemic. He seems to be shaking his head, but I'm happy to provide him with that detail. So that is why we're now beginning to see that recruitment come through the pipeline, because that investment was made a while back. He is absolutely right to continue to raise the issues about morale. And that's why we have the Staff Wellbeing Hub. But anything more we can do to help morale, I know Unite the Union have raised some issues about morale, but what more can be done to help morale in the ambulance service, I'm more than happy to speak to them, take ideas from wherever they come from. But staff morale will be important and we'll continue to invest in the ambulance service. And hopefully on Tuesday, with Parliament's approval, I can give further details of some of the other actions that we're looking to bring forward during this challenging phase.
Question number two, Mark Ruskell.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what its position is on the proposed timetable changes set out by ScotRail in its Fit for the Future consultation.
Minister Graham Day.
Presiding Officer, as Mark Ruskell points out, ScotRail is conducting a public consultation on the proposed May 22 timetable, which closes on the 1st of October. And I would encourage everyone with an interest to make their views known. The proposed timetable would operate 100 services more than the current pandemic timetable, responding to changed travel patterns. ScotRail are of the view that the vast majority of customers will find either no change to their current service or that their service improves with a more regular interval between services, and so more trains being provided. But I recognise that there are some localised concerns about that, and as I say, I would encourage the public and members to make their views known through the consultation.
Mark Ruskell.
Can I thank the Minister for that response? ScotRail's proposed new timetable will result in some unacceptable cuts in services and extensions to journey times. This will impact, Minister, on people, particularly in Stirling, Dunblane, Perth and Kirkcaldy. I've been actively encouraging residents to share their views with ScotRail as part of the consultation. Later this month, I'll be hosting a meeting with constituents to better understand how these changes will impact them. Does the Minister agree that any significant changes in rail services must only be done after real and meaningful consultation with rail users? And does the Minister agree that ScotRail should accept my invitation to meet with rail users to ensure that their voices are heard?
Minister.
President Officer, I very much commend Mark Ruskell for the approach he's taken to this. And yes, I would encourage ScotRail to engage. What I think I've said before is that I've never seen draft proposals contained within a consultation which are flawless or could not be improved upon. But I would say gently to Mark Ruskell that timetables are complex creatures, and when you revisit them, it's not as simple as simply restoring or tweaking component parts. I know he has very real concerns, as he's noted, about impacts on Perth and Kirkcaldy, for example. But Invergowrie and Glen Eagles in his region benefit greatly from the proposed changes. Unpicking some of the planned alterations could undermine those gains.
Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Minister if he plans to keep these timetable cuts when ScotRail is nationalised?
Minister.
President Officer, as I've pointed out, this is a gain of 100 services from the present timetable. Timetables evolve. Mr Simpson knows that, and the whole point of this is to gradually build back and, in doing so, recognise the emerging travel patterns that we will see as people's return to work arrangements become more apparent and leisure activities become more apparent. So this is a baseline for which we can build and align the services with the need of the travelling public.
Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Could the Minister provide information on any benefits that would potentially arise from the draft proposals that have been considered under the proposed timetable changes set out by ScotRail in its Fit for the Future consultation?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, briefly, I have already touched on Invergowrie and Glen Eagles' example. I think Dumfries would be another example that benefits from us. But I also recognise that there are areas which feel aggrieved about the proposals, and that's why it's important that everyone engages in this consultation.
Question number three, Liam Kerr.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the reported decline in air passengers travelling through Scottish airports.
Minister Graham Day.
Presiding Officer, in common with airports around the world, Scotland's airports have seen a collapse in demand throughout the pandemic. The restrictions in place on travel, both at home and abroad, were necessary, of course, to protect public health. Before the pandemic, Scotland was better connected with the rest of the world than ever before, and we are actively seeking to recover traffic and secure new routes, whilst also ensuring safe travel for passengers and airport staff. But in doing that, of course, we have to attempt to do this in a way that reduces carbon emissions from the aviation sector.
Liam Kerr.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Aberdeen Airport recently reported passenger numbers collapsing by two-thirds during 2020, leading to its owner posting pre-tax losses of £131 million. Now, this has had a major impact on the connectivity the Minister referenced, which the North East, already battered by huge business rates, retail closures and poor transport links, can ill afford. Other governments have recognised the strategic importance of aviation by putting support packages in place. Will this one?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, this is a problem that is affecting airports across the UK. And in fact, I think Aberdeen is faring better than some of our other domestic airports. there's considerable effort going in by the Transport Scotland aviation team, working with a multitude of airlines and with airports to restore connectivity. And recognising, Presiding Officer, you have a lot of questions to get through. I'll leave it at that, but I will offer Mr Kerr the opportunity to meet and to go through some of this in detail if he would find that useful.
Thank you. I call Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister set out some of the detail on the work that's being done on route recovery in the air travel sector in Scotland?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, that work is extensive. It has primarily focused in the short term on reconnecting with North America, Canada in particular, but the aviation team is working actively in other areas for wider route recovery. And again, if Siobhan Brown has a particular interest in this, I'm more than happy to meet with her and talk her through the detail.
Question number 4, Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its proposals to establish a publicly owned energy company that will generate and supply energy.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson.
I set out in our manifesto earlier this year and in my written response in June, we will focus government efforts on a dedicated National Public Energy Agency adapt to the scale and nature of decarbonising 1 million homes and 50,000 non-domestic buildings by 2030. This will provide the coordination required to accelerate the delivery of transformative change, where almost every building in Scotland will switch to zero carbon heating, and will lead on educating the public on required changes, providing financial and non-financial support and expert advice to national and local government to deliver this unprecedented project.
Dean Lockhart.
Thank you. So we have gone from an energy company that would actually generate and supply energy at lower cost to a virtual agency with no additional budget, no additional staff or resource, as confirmed by the Cabinet Secretary to the Net Zero Committee earlier this week. The Cabinet Secretary tells us that this virtual agency, which is probably a website, with no additional staff or resources, is a better answer and a better way to address the challenges of climate change and fuel poverty. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with stakeholders that the failure to establish a publicly owned energy company has been a complete policy failure?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the challenges which we face have changed very significantly over the course of the last couple of years, and with the publication of our updated climate change plan and the very significant statutory targets we now face in meeting our climate change commitments, we require to decarbonise domestic heating systems and non-domestic heating systems at a very considerable rate over the course of the next 8 to 9 years. Key to achieving that is coordinating the action that will be necessary in order to do so effectively. And that's exactly what a public agency will be able to do. Alongside that, we're also exploring the provision of heat as a service. We consulted on this issue earlier in the year, and we're looking at how that could be delivered potentially through a public energy company. That's one of the aspects that could help to support us in taking coordinated action in tackling issues such as not only climate change, but also fuel poverty.
Question number 5, Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what support it can provide to people undertaking managed quarantine at Scottish airports who are unable to afford the costs but not in receipt of welfare benefits.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson.
International travellers not receiving qualifying welfare benefits can contact Corporate Travel Management, the UK Government's travel agent, to access a deferred payment plan. This is only available to UK residents or students who have a visa to study in the UK. A repayment plan needs to be paid back in 12 monthly instalments. The Scottish Government have additional hardship measures in place beyond that of the UK Government. If a person residing in Scotland meets appropriate criteria and is unable to repay the debt, the Scottish Government will fully cover the costs of hotel quarantine and cancel the repayment plan.
Emma Roddick.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer. Given the inadequacies of the Universal Credit Application and Award Systems, will an expansion of existing eligibility for Scottish Government support to those not on Universal Credit but struggling to pay the costs be considered?
Cabinet Secretary.
Acting Officer, I can confirm to the Member that we already have an extended list, so Universal Credit is only one of the benefits that we take into consideration. If someone is having difficulty meeting the costs with managed quarantine, if they're on benefits such as if they receive child tax credits, work tax credits, housing benefit, income support, pension credit, income-based job seekers allowance, any income-related benefit, then we take that into account in considering whether we should cancel the repayment plan for them.
Question number 6, Sarah Boyack.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how it will address the backlog in NHS dentistry.
Minister Marie Todd.
We're moving forward rapidly with NHS dental recovery and are supporting the sector to build back to a pre-pandemic level of activity. We've invested additional funding of £5 million to improve ventilation in dental premises and a further £7.5 million for the purchase of speed-adjusting handpieces. These particular pieces can be used in a wide range of clinical procedures where standard non-aerosol precautions may be applied. These measures, alongside a 50% increase in the amount of free enhanced PPE available, will make it possible for NHS dental teams to see substantially more patients while operating under the current infection prevention and control measures required for safe operation of dental treatment.
Sarah Boyack.
Can I thank the Minister for her reply? I have also previously received a response saying that a record number of people are registered with an NHS dentist, but constituents are writing to me concerned that they're still unable to find an NHS dentist who they can register with, that the delays in appointments are not getting shorter, and I'm aware of NHS dentists who have gone private. So is the Minister not concerned about this state of affairs, and what action is the Scottish Government taking to fix it?
Minister.
I am concerned about the state of affairs. The challenge for dentistry is the aerosol-producing procedures and the infection prevention and control measures that are constraining the level of activity they can undertake. As we emerge from the pandemic, we will expect the situation to improve. Dental practices will be able to register and see new patients. At present, because of the restrictions, it's more difficult for dental practices to see new patients. As the arrangements for dental registration is made through the local health board, then a patient who is having difficulty finding NHS dental care should contact the health board first in order to access appropriate care. If there are examples of patients being offered private care instead of NHS care, then that is completely wrong. It's completely unacceptable. An NHS registered patient should not be offered private dental care if the same treatment is available on the NHS, and instances of that behaviour should be reported to the NHS board. If you have examples of that, I'm happy for you to write to my office and my officials will pass that information to the relevant board.